My guest today is a great singer-songwriter who has a brand new solo album coming out called Lost in the Ghostlight. Comes out February 17th. Pleased to welcome back Tim Bowness.
Hello there.
Hello. How are you?
I'm good. How are you doing, man?
I'm all right, I think. Other than a headache, I'm in a darkened room with a headache.
Hopefully you had a good Christmas break or a Happy New Year's and all that.
Yeah, it's fine, I think. What about you? Very, very quiet, very sort of family-oriented, but, you know, we stayed in the one room for probably 2 weeks, you know.
Yeah, exactly. Got a little time away from the computer, which is always good. Well, cool, man. Always good to speak with you. I have to say, personally, I love the new album. Man, I think each album has gotten better and better and better, and this one is just really fantastic. All the way through, it's just awesome.
Thank you. Well, I think it's one of the things I was quite pleased with. I think that it's a very solid album statement from the beginning to the end. There's something about it where it doesn't seem to flag for me, and I'm really pleased with the two other albums I did for Inside Out. But it's quite strange listening to them in retrospect. The arc of this album seems better and seems more substantial, and that isn't to diminish the other albums, because I still think it's got some of my strongest material. And I think, you know, in some ways, from a solo work point of view, it feels like a bit of a renaissance, in that I believe the solo work is at least competing with No Man work, which I think previously quite a lot of my side projects, and there are exceptions to it, but I think previously most of them probably were in the shadow of No Man's work, and I'd like to think that these have come out of the shadow of No Man's work.
Well, do you think that when doing the solo albums that you were in some cases maybe feeling your way around that environment, and now you've become more comfortable with that? Or is there something to that?
It's possibly true. I mean, I think I was initially quite reluctant. I think with the first album, as I may have said at the time, it was my idea of what a No Man album should be, because I'd sort of written the demos with No Man in mind. And because Stephen Wilson didn't have the time to work on this, he said, well, look, I'll mix it, but I think you should release it as your solo album. And the interesting thing is that it was much more my solo album than My Hotel Year had been, because I made a solo album in 2004, and it was a very episodic, bitty album, because what it was I was working on three or four projects that weren't quite coming to fruition. They were all sort of interesting, but they weren't working. And so I drew the best songs from each of the four projects. And I think what you got was 11 songs with really sort of three or four different directions that didn't gel as well as they should. And Abandoned Dance Hall Dreams I'd written very much as an album, but an album for No Man. And I think that in the end, the album was my idea of what a No Man album could be. And then with Stupid Things That Mean the World, it was probably my idea of where a Tim Bowness solo album should go after Abandoned Dance Hall Dreams. It's taking the elements that I thought were me. And this is distinct from that in a way that musically it's followed a slightly different path. And that path has been dictated by the story or the concepts of the album. And perhaps you're right, because this time I just kind of followed the idea through obsessively and didn't think about necessarily what it represented.
Right. So I always wonder about the ideas where an artist's head is for a concept album. One, are you a fan of those, you know, the sort of the history of the concept album, and you felt like you had one in you at some point that you wanted to always do, or you just got inspired by this story and it just, you know, became what it became?
I think it's a combination of both. I've always loved concept albums, and I've always loved albums with a great deal of detail, thought, obsessiveness, and particularly for me, I was like Pete Townsend's conceptual work, and I really liked the way in which he talked about being a musician himself, and also people's reactions to him being a musician. And of course, he had a project called Lifehouse in the early 1970s, which he never fully realized, and that's one of the great concept albums that got away. And and there's been some inspiration in that respect, that I've always liked albums such as Quadrophenia, Psychedelic by Pete Townsend, and or The Who, and some of Roger Waters' work. You know, The Wall, I think, was an album that when I was a teenager, I absolutely adored. And so as a format, it's something that's always interested me. But I've always kind of gone before for sort of themed albums. So with some of the No Man albums, like Together with Stranger or Schoolyard Ghosts, or with Abandoned Dancehall Dreams and Stupid Things That Mean the World, they were always albums that had an overriding mood rather than anything else. So they were concept albums in as much as something like Dark Side of the Moon is a concept album, because that basically is several separate songs with an overall theme, perhaps, of the pressures of the modern world. And I suppose that with Together with Stranger, that really was a kind of a breakup album. Abandoned Dancehall Dreams, I just kind of had an overriding idea of faded grandeur and perhaps people who'd passed through these buildings that had once had social significance. So that was kind of, it was themed rather than story. But yeah, it's a long-winded way of saying that I guess I've always wanted to make a story album, but what I didn't want was something that was overly complex, overly obscure, because as much as I love the concept album, it certainly has produced quite a lot of works that are willfully difficult, I'd say. And as much as I quite enjoy going through the sleeve notes of some of these albums, it wasn't something I particularly wanted to make. But yes, I've always wanted to make a sort of a story album, and weirdly, you know, once you have that story and that set of ideas, rather than being restricting, it's actually quite liberating, and you find that you're more inventively applying yourself to what you can do with that story. And so, yeah, once you have that, it becomes quite all-consuming. And I guess that for me, it was a point of obsession, because the subjects it deals with, a career in music, and particularly a career in music during a particular time of music, and music obsession, are ones that interest me. And I said to somebody earlier today that the interviews have focused my thinking somewhat, in that on one level, I thought, actually, this is almost like a wildlife documentary on an endangered species. And on another level, it's a bit like, it's the first time I've done a story album, but also it's a bit like, because I don't feel I've lost my identity on this album, it still feels very much me in terms of the lyrics and the emotion and perhaps the intensity. And it almost feels as if this is the first time I've made a period drama. You know, it's a bit like I've made my version of Downton Abbey or The Queen. You know, it may be a completely different era and a completely different subject, but in some ways approaching it, it was almost like doing a period drama. It was my interpretation of events from a certain time. And that, of course, opens up possibilities as to whether I do, you know, other period dramas, you know.
Right, sure. The sequel, the prequel, you know, all that kind of stuff.
Absolutely. Next one is going to be the disco ball, you know.
Right. Well, one thing that is cool in the album, Lost in the Ghostlight, which comes out February 17th, is also the artwork and the whole thing. So the idea of the concept allows you to play with everything. And that's one thing that I remember in speaking with Stephen Wilson, is that he enjoys of the concept album, is you get to immerse yourself in everything, from the liner notes to the cover to the tour visuals. You know, everything becomes all about that. It makes it like sort of like a movie, like an experience. So how much of the artwork and the planning of that did you get involved with and sort of get to play with?
Yeah, well, I mean, I quite enjoy that as well. I mean, certainly on previous albums, there have always been visual links, and especially when I've worked with Jared Gosling, who did the sleeve artwork for Lost in the Ghostlight, we've always had quite detailed sleeves and sleeves that relate to the characters that the album's songs are about. And this time, it's fair to say that we went to town on it. This was perhaps the most excessively detailed sleeve and backstory I've ever had or done. And I wrote a full biography of the band and the artist that the album was about. I wrote a full discography with album titles, tracks, career direction. And I gave this to Jared. And we also talked about his habits, his personality. And he greatly enjoyed this. It's always nice working with Jared because he's an enthusiastic person to deal with, and he also has some wonderful ideas. So yeah, I provided him with an incredibly detailed biography, character breakdown and discography, and he then took that and played with it and went further than even I'd suggested. And then of course I gave him feedback on what he'd done. And one of the great things is that I had the career discography from sort of 1967 to 2017, and every album is detailed, and he does covers for these albums. So although it's one album sleeve, I've actually got about 14 album sleeves in there.
Yeah, that's really cool.
You know, and he brilliantly evokes the era, you know, from the excitement and exploration of the 60s and 70s to the band becoming maybe slightly tired in the 80s and some fairly hideous, very typically 80s graphics. And his 2017 sleeve is a very fine Carl Glover imitation. You know, it almost could be the next No Man album on K-Scope. You know, it's very odd, but you know, brilliantly detailed. And yeah, we put a lot of thought in what went into it, you know, from any details from the name of the wine to the moisturizer he has and so on. And yeah, it was fantastic to get immersed in that, because of course the music is paramount, the music's important, and I completely threw myself into the music. And the sleeve, I guess, that came about after the album had been completed, and that became a separate obsession, really. And yeah, you know, very enjoyable and as detailed as you'd think.
Yeah. So the name of the band that it's sort of about is Moonshot Manchild, right? Am I getting that right?
The band is called Moonshot, and it was selected very deliberately because I sort of, you know, I've always had an obsession with music of the late 60s, early 70s anyway, because I think it was one of the great periods of musical innovation, and that could be in rock, in jazz, and it could also be in film. You know, if you think of Stanley Kubrick's 2001, and I was thinking that in some ways maybe that was tied in with the fact that at the time man was looking outside itself. It was sending the first explorers into space. It was creating the first rocket that goes to the moon, and we have the moon landings. And I kind of wondered if that psychologically affect the world of the arts as well, that you got some amazingly imaginative, mind-expanding cinema, you know, such as Stanley Kubrick's 2001. And then you also had in music various revolutions from the progressive rock movement to the jazz rock movement onwards, where music seemed to be sort of aiming for the stratosphere. It didn't seem to have any bounds in terms of its invention. And of course there have been lots of musical movements since that have been inventive, but they've been much more earthbound. If you think of punk, you think of post-punk, or you think of acid house, there's something much more earthbound about that music compared to the 60s and 70s. And so yeah. I titled the band Moonshot because on one level it's the era of the moonshot, the rocket to the moon, and on another level Moonshot's got a meaning, which is it's your big idea. You know, the moonshot is the big idea you've got, you know, whether that's creating the internet or something. So yeah, I kind of tied it in with the period.
I like that song as well, the second track on the album, Moonshot Manchild, which is why I referenced that. That's probably my favorite track on the album, but it seems sort of like a central song to the story. So talk about the timeline of the story and how the album kind of starts and goes through that and the timeline of the songs.
Well, I sort of see it as being set now. So effectively it's a 2017 concert, and let's say, you know, he's playing the Wakefield Auditorium to 350 hardcore fans who are very much the same age as him. And I visualize this character as being sort of 15 to 20 years older than I was. It was a particular generation of musician who had come through the revolutionary 60s and 70s, had a level of success globally, but now was kind of playing out his career to an aging audience. And from having been culturally significant, was perhaps now just providing golden oldies comfort food for his own generation. So it was about his backstage thought processes. So I sort of imagined him backstage 2017. And then the lyrics themselves deal with different phases So Worlds of Yesterday starts with almost his realization of where he is in the present day, that he's perhaps become a bit of a tired parody of himself. But then you have songs like You'll Be the Silence, and that is very specifically partly based on conversations I've had with musicians of that era and how it affected them, but it's partly about how certain progressive and classic rock musicians felt in the time of punk and new wave, that they felt irrelevant, passed over by the press, and it very much affected their confidence. And so that song is almost about the music perhaps becoming slightly more complacent because of its level of success, but also the artist being deeply hurt by a rejection of what it sees of a younger audience, of the music press. And another song that sort of deals with that is Kill the Pain That's Killing You, which I kind of see as about the breakdown of his relationship, that, you know, this constant touring, this rock life is tearing apart the marriage and the child. His wife is having an affair. And the song effectively is about him, in a sense, getting drunk to self-piteously, you know, drown his sorrows, but it's also about the fact that the modern world is changing and he's not keeping up with it. So a few of the songs are sort of set in a late 1970s, early 1980s point where the musician is falling apart both in terms of personal life and creative life. And of course, you know, that wasn't the case for everybody, because there were quite a few musicians from that era who completely transcended it. You know, Robert Fripp, Peter Gabriel, Peter Hamill, all of them continued to be very creative and very relevant. And bands like Pink Floyd just continued to make extremely grand and successful statements that were every bit as brilliant as they had been. But there were a lot of folk rock, jazz rock, prog rock bands that were killed in the late 1970s, a bit like jazz musicians who were kind of killed by the emergence of the Beatles.
Right.
That, sure. You know, from selling out clubs in New York, Chicago, wherever, suddenly everybody wants pop, everybody wants rock. And there are, you know, all sorts of times in music, but I was specifically thinking of that time. Another timeline one would be the very last track, Distant Summers, where I kind of see it that the character has got to this stage where they're questioning themselves and their value, and they get right back to the core of what it was that they're doing. That so Distant Summers is almost about this 1967 realization of how much music means to them, what music can do, and it's in a way quite an optimistic end to the album, because it's the character kind of reconnecting with their reason for making music. And that's one of the reasons why I deliberately got Ian Anderson on that track, because, you know, when I was an early teenager, Jethro Tull were a huge influence. And I think, you know, he's a great all-round talent, brilliant lyricist, brilliant songwriter, brilliant player. And so for me, having somebody who was a formative influence for me, you know, one of the reasons I would have wanted to make music, being on the track that's about the character, one of the reasons why he wants to make music, was intentional. And it was, you know, quite a moving moment in its own way.
Speaking of the musicians on the album, along with Ian Anderson, you have a really impressive list of people on the album: Colin Edwin and Bruce Sword, and of course Steven is mixing and mastering it. So talk about mm-hmm. how you pulled all that impressive list together. I mean, is it you guys meet at a bar and talk about who can join, or you pick up the, you know, pick up the phone, or how's it happen?
Yeah, we have a dream list. Now, well, some of it is part of my live band. So Colin Edwin, Stephen Bennett, and Andy Booker have been in my live band for quite a few years. And I've been lucky to work with them because, you know, they're all great players and very versatile. And, you know, Colin, I think, is highly underrated, really, because, you know, on the album, you'll hear him do bass harmonic solos. You'll hear fretless bass. You'll hear double bass. And then you'll hear straightforward rock bass as well. You know, he's a very versatile player and very easy to work with. So three of the players were part of my regular band, but I made a few changes. My regular guitarist, Michael Bearpark, who, you know, I love as a player and as a person, his style's very abstract, and I wanted something different. So I went for Bruce Sword because he played on a couple of tracks on my last album, guitar. And what I like about his style is he's very direct, and he's very melodic, and I think that might be because he's a songwriter himself, so he does what's right for the piece Whereas Michael's quite an innovative player and almost plays against the piece, and that can work superbly in certain contexts. I very much wanted somebody who would play with the material. So Bruce was brought in for that reason. And, you know, I think did a splendid job of being just a solo guitarist, you know. We also had Hux Netamarm from Partus, who are an Inside Out band you might know. And it was interesting, contrasting, because he plays on half the album and Andrew Booker plays on half the album. And Andy is a very sort of jittery, forward-thinking drummer, and he was perfect for pieces like Kill the Pain That's Killing You and You Wanted to Be Seen. And Hux has got an incredibly relaxed, organic sound, and he was perfect for pieces like You'll Be the Silence and Moonshot Manchild. So, you know, different players were chosen for their different strengths. Kit Watkins came about because we've been in contact over the internet for years, and actually the version of Camel that Kit was in is one of the first ever gigs I went to. In the early 1980s, I saw him play, and oddly, you know, he's followed my music, I followed his, and it just seemed the right time to get him involved, and he produced a couple of wonderful flute performances on the album. Andrew Keeling is a classical composer who's worked with me, Robert Fripp, but, and also a lot of classical musicians, and he's somebody who's arranged strings on the last two albums. And he's always a really nice wild card, because you give him an idea of what you want and he'll sort of do it, and then he'll do something on top of that, which is always interesting. So I like getting him involved. And this time as well, he played a lot of flute, because one of the instruments that's very featured on the album is flute. It's on six of the eight tracks. And he's another fantastic flautist. And so, yeah, it was a combination of sort of thinking, right, who's right for the piece? And, you know, what do I want? And obviously with the mixing and mastering, you know, Stephen is one of the best mixers in the world. So, you know, I'm lucky that obviously I've been in a band with him for quite some time, so I can draw on his expertise. And, yeah, it was great to get him involved again as well.
Is it sort of an easy, you know, like minds, thinking alike? You know, he can listen to the music, and without having to really talk to you, he knows what to do with it, because you guys have sort of a... almost a similar style, similar vibe, been in bands together, all of that.
Absolutely. I mean, no disrespect to Bruce, because, you know, Bruce did a great job mixing Stupid Things That Mean the World, and I think it's as good as Abandoned Dancehall Dreams in terms of sound, but it took him quite a long time to get into the groove of that sound, whereas with Stephen it was instant, you know, and it was with Abandoned Dancehall Dreams. And of course Stephen's progressed since then as well, so, but yeah, he knows what I want and what I like. I give him certain instructions and he does it perfectly almost immediately, you know, whereas, you know, with Bruce he did it brilliantly, but it took quite a long time. But that's, and that's no fault of his whatsoever, because I think you're right, it's because I know Stephen intimately and he knows what I like. And so yeah, it was almost like I got what I wanted with almost a minimum of fuss, and it makes the process a lot easier in some ways. Sure. Because you know you're in safe hands, really.
So now that you have this album out, where does your head sort of go after putting so much effort into an album? Now it's about to come out. And you might have a few singles and some different things happening. And then, you know, where do you go? Do you take a few months off? Do you start writing the new one right away? What happens?
Well, I usually immerse myself in something else almost straight away or at the time of the album's completion, just so I don't suffer from, as we call it, post-album depression. You know? And interestingly, this time, you know, I finished an album. I've nearly finished an album off with Peter Chilvers, which is maybe more typical of what I do in that it's a singer songwriter with electronics. But I think is very much the best work we've done. And another project I've done, almost again, if you like, a period drama, was one of the first bands I was ever in, which is my pre-No Man band called Plenty. We've re-recorded all of the songs that we wrote in the 1980s. And of course, the singing is very different. And I've had to rewrite half of the lyrics because I wasn't so sure about what I was on about then, you know. Right. It's like, so I've done this, but interestingly enough, finishing Lost in the Ghostlight, it felt very satisfying. And so, I haven't felt as much of a sort of dramatic impetus to progress with other projects, really. Yeah, so at the moment, I've got these two albums that are in the process of being finished and hopefully will be released sometime in 2017. But it almost feels like I'm waiting for that next big project or big idea, that next moonshot, if you will.
Right.
And of course, you know, ever since the album was completed in, you know, late autumn or the fall, as you have it, last year, a lot of work has been done either on the cover or obviously recently with promotion. So it's kind of become quite an all-encompassing thing, and it may well also become a live thing. I mean, I did a couple of gigs in November, co-headlines with a band called I Am the Morning, and they went well, and you know, we're kind of wondering whether we should do that again as a sort of co-headline, because it was a nice mixture of bands in that our music's very different, but there's a kind of feel that suits both bands and was quite complimentary.
Yeah, and they're starting to get a lot of publicity too of late for their last album, so that's a nice match. Always great to talk to you, man. Like I said, the album is awesome. I think that I think people are going to love it, and the music just keeps getting better. So I wish you all the best with it.
Yeah, thank you.
Too bad you're not going on one of these cruises. We got to get you on one of these cruises next time.
I'd love to do it, yeah. I mean, you know, got to get someone to right. fight my corner for it, I think.
Yeah, exactly.
And someday it'd be nice to go to Florida as well, obviously.
So. Yeah, good weather. All right, man, I'll be in touch. Thank you.
Yeah, nice speaking. See you.
See you, man. Bye. Thanks to Tim for the interview. We're going to close with a track off of Lost in the Ghostlight. This is You Wanted to Be Seen. For upcoming news and interviews, please check theprogreport.com. Follow us on Facebook, at The Prog Report on Twitter, and download the podcast on iTunes. Thanks.
Doors were open, signs were clear.